Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Ask the Unicorn. I'm Uhura Z. Welcome to our video show. This is Kazi.
Hello. Today is episode 23, and it is March 5th.
For those of you that have birthdays today, happy birthday. That would be Donna. Donna Kinnison? Donna Clark Kinnison?
Yeah.
Happy birthday,
Happy birthday,
Donna!
Yay!
I hope you've had a wonderful birthday. For those of you that have birthdays, Pisces is the most majestic of all of the signs, in case you all didn't know that. Just letting you know. We will be answering a lot of questions today. Hopefully you have a lot of questions. I'll answer any type of question that you have, so long as it pertains to the metaphysical, the spiritual, the mystical, and the paranormal. No question is too difficult for me to answer. However, there are two types of questions I do not answer, and most of you know what those are, but for those of you that are just joining us, I don't answer questions to the area of when someone is going to die or whether or not someone's spouse is cheating on them. I stay away from those particular matters, and there's nothing that you can say that is going to change my mind. Now, beyond that, any other question is fair game, as long as it has to do, again, with the paranormal, the mystical, the spiritual, and the metaphysical. Now, I'm pretty easy. I'm kind of like a farmer. I shoot straight from the hip. If I can eliminate all of the complicated answers, I will do so. Every once in a while, I have to use school words, and I will do my best to answer things for you very simply, so that you understand them, so that there's no guesswork involved. I won't say things to you like, there's snow on the mountaintop, and you're approaching the snow. I'll just tell you very, very plainly how things are, okay? There's no feather touches the stone, and, you know, none of that kind of malarkey. Now, hopefully we have a very, very busy chat room this evening, and for those of you that need to call, you can call us with your questions, and that is area code 207-347-5686. Again, that is area code 207-347-5686. I love it when people call in, and if you have a good question, I will actually air it, and you'll be able to hear your voice. So I might make this suggestion. For those of you that are calling in, you might turn the sound down while you're on the television with me, while you're on the show with me. That way you don't get confused by the echo or the delay. All right, so what have we got so far, Kazi?
This first question comes from Melinda, your Melinda. She asks, "Hi Z, my question is this. I am aware of my own power and spirituality, but often suppress it for whatever reasons I am unsure of. If I wanted to nurture these gifts rather than suppress them, what would you say would be the best tools to use daily to make the process of acceptance and compassion routine, for a lack of better word? P.S. Oh. I miss you, friend."
Okay. One of the best methods that you can use is just ask yourself three questions. And I've said this before. You have to identify with yourself as a spiritual being, which you do. But you also have to identify with yourself as a personal being. I think a lot of times when we endeavor to develop ourselves and we take on a spiritual path, we forget that we're human. And we have to deal with that particular part of ourselves. So you might ask yourself these three questions daily. Who am I? Where am I? And what am I doing? Now, there are answers for those questions. You kind of have to make sure that you do answer yourself back. You can come up with a lot of different answers, and that's up to you. But the simplest way is this. You can answer yourself by saying, okay, who am I? I'm a spiritual being. Where am I? I live in a spiritual world. What am I doing? I am growing and evolving daily. Now, beyond that, what you might also do is say, listen, I have gone through many things in my life, and I think it's about time for me to stop shrinking. In other words, I'm no shrinking violet. I have a big personality. And I need to be able to express that personality in order for me to live comfortably. Now, with all of the things that are going on in your life, I'm sure that you can relate to the fact that some things need your addressing all the time. So if you're someone that has a spiritual gift, and I know you personally, and I know that you have quite a bit of spiritual gifts, you can't hide behind a problem. What you have to do is come out into the open so that perhaps that problem will dissipate based upon your expressing your own spiritual gift. Remember, the more energy that you put into the universe, the more energy the universe will put into you. But if you have all of this talent and you're for some reason talking yourself out of using it because either you feel as though you're going to lose something or it's uncomfortable or it will make you look a certain way, then you don't really get to be yourself. And there are a lot of people that are around you that could particularly use your light. So you almost owe it to them and owe it to yourself to be as expressive as you possibly can. So ask yourself those three questions and then do something. Do something that reflects your answer. You're a spiritual being. So the first rule of spirituality being reality, be real with yourself and with others. Second, you live in a spiritual world. Realize that the area that you're in physically at that particular moment may not be full of people that are spiritually enlightened, but they are at least real. And you can be yourself because you deserve to be yourself. This is part of your heritage. It is part of who you are and your creed. So be yourself. Three, you are growing and evolving daily. A lot of times we don't express ourselves because we're afraid of making a mistake. But you know, you gotta understand this. The best of us who have ever walked this planet made a lot of mistakes. A lot of mistakes. And there are some of them that will tell you that 99% of the time they screw up. The other portion of the time they just get lucky. But then they will also tell you that they follow the will of the universe and therefore they're always right. So you kind of have to take that approach as well. And you know, Lindy, it's important for you to be able to express yourself. You are a very powerful artist. And art is one of those things that has been so underestimated throughout the centuries and throughout the eons. When art, everything sprang from art, no matter what it is. You hear people talking about science daily, but science sprang from art. Science is one of those things that just says, oh, this is what that color is. And that's really all that science is good for. Engineering is something different, but artists are engineers. You have the ability to bring things that are from the intangible world into the tangible world. I would say that that's a wonderful skill. You just need to keep doing it. I know you know who you are as a spiritual being, but knowing who you are as a spiritual being and being who you are two different things. So we've got to start practicing on being who we are. I hope that helps you. And I miss you too. And I miss my brother. All right. What else do we have here?
This next question is from Charlie, and she asks, why does it feel at times that I'm waking into a mirror universe when I go someplace away from home? Case in point, went to a doctor's office in Pennsylvania, and I swear, and so did the doctor that we had met already, and the receptionist. Even the patients in the waiting room all looked familiar, as if I had been there before.
Well, this goes back to something I was talking to you before. Realizing there are different dimensional yous. There are thousands of different dimensions, and perhaps one of those dimensions came very, very close to you just before you. And they all thought that they had seen you before. But realizing that there are past yous, remember, we talked about this, people always want to talk about their past lives, but they don't realize that there are parallel lives, and at the same time, there are future lives. So when you go out, perhaps you did find a, not necessarily mirror universe, but another dimensionality to your own life, and you stepped right into that reality, which means that one of them had to go. And that one that went left a space, and you clicked right into it. And so when you walked into this place, they said, well, didn't we already had this talk. What are you doing here again? See, and what I might call that is a real natural phenomenon. You stepped into an alternate life. Oh, now, what
Charlie,
you...
Charlie is on the phone.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to talk to you here, and I'm going to talk to you on the phone, too. Because what you did was you actually stumbled on... Hello, Charlie. How are you? You have to turn your radio, your thing down.
Wait, what? I'm confused. Hold on.
Turn your sound down.
Okay.
Okay, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
Yeah? Well, it's good to hear from you. For those of you that don't know...
Why are you so lagged? I'm like freaking out here. So this is like a freaking time warp.
Well, that's what I told you. You have to kind of turn your sound down. Otherwise, you're going to get confused by the real time and the lag time on the...
Computer.
On the computer. Yeah. But for those of you that don't know, this is Charlie Alejandro. Charlie Alejandro did the show with me before. And hopefully at some point in time, she'll come back and do the show with me again. As soon as she can get herself out of the different reflections of her own universe.
You're going to freak her out even more.
Okay, so what you actually did was stepped into an opportunity. Now what you have to look around for is to see how things are different. Because if an old dimensional life disappeared and you clicked right into a new reality or a reality that existed, then you have to look and see if there's some things that have either improved or things that have changed. Do you understand? It's like I'm looking at the phone talking to you is the weirdest thing. You know, I know you're in that little tube thing there, but I'm looking at the phone. You know? So, you're going to have to kind of look around and see if you find anything that's different. And that's going to take you going out and exploring it. Do you understand?
Yeah, okay.
You know, because it's very, very real. I mean, it's not something that you imagined. I mean, and you're one of the most grounded individuals that I know. So you clicked into a different awareness. And there could be all kinds of things that have changed.
I'm telling you, it's so weird. Like, I walked in and, like, I made the appointment online, so I had never seen him. And it was just so bizarre when... the familiarity in the waiting area, but the worst was when I walked in and the doctor's like, hey, how are you doing? How's it going? And we're looking at each other. He's like, you've been here before, right? I'm like, no, but I'm looking at him like I know him. I knew the way he was dressed, his mannerisms, what he was going to say. And he kept doing the same thing, like, are you sure? Did I see you at the other office? I'm like, I'm absolutely sure. I've never seen you before. And from there, it just got even freakier because the patients that were sitting in the waiting area all looked familiar, like, I know you. And they kept looking at me like, wait, we know you too. So it's just a really surrealistic experience.
That's awesome. Usually that comes up as a deja vu. But in your particular case, it came up as an actual third dimensional reality.
Mm-hmm.
Which is brilliant, actually. It's awesome. I really do suggest you to look around, do some things, and see what things are different. See if you feel any different. See if there's something that has changed, even in your health or your mentality or in your lifestyle. See if there's some new people or people have different expressions. Because there's never things that are going to be the exact same. If you clicked into a different reality, there are subtle things that have changed. And you're going to have to find them.
Okay, I think that I see where you're coming from, because I know that one thing that was definitely different was my attitude, because from the jump I told him, look, you're not a miracle worker, I don't expect answers, I just need to be able to get back to a semblance of normality as best as I can.
Right.
And when you hear a medical doctor say to you, I'm not going to beep beep crap you because this is real, this is not, it was refreshing.
Right, right.
To have someone be frankly and honest with you, especially someone in that profession. So
right.
I can see where that's different.
Right.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, but it was just like the weirdest experience I've ever had in my life.
Well, that's...
You know me, I've had some funky experiences.
Yeah, I do know you, as a matter of fact. And we're waiting for you to come up and see us, actually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that we can... What do you mean, uh-huh?
Mm-hmm, she says, mm-hmm.
What kind of thing was that to say?
No, it's because you're coming in, like, broken up.
I'm sorry. Yeah, can you hear me now?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, good. I'm saying we're waiting for you to come up and see us.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I was like, what did he say? That's what?
You know, we all miss you up here. And I'm sure the fans miss seeing your lovely face on camera, too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do. I miss you guys as well.
You didn't even hear me.
I really appreciate you answering the question, and it was really weird that it happened today, because like I said, it was just so vivid and so weird.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, you can always call in. I like it when people call in, you know that. And hopefully we get to see you very, very soon, sister.
Sounds great.
I don't know if she heard all of that. Did you hear any of that?
Did you hear all of? Did you hear all of that?
What?
Did you hear anything I said?
I did. I heard you saying that you guys miss me, that I can call anytime I want.
Yes.
And something about camera and my face. So I don't know if you said my face broke the camera or something along those lines.
Anyway, I hope you're going to be on later. I'll talk to you a little later, okay? All right, so do you got your Skype running yet?
Yes, it's up and running.
Okay, good, because I'm going to Skype you. You better pick up.
I will.
Okay, love you.
All right.
Talk to you, bye.
You too. Bye.
That was Charlie, and as you can tell, we're real close. All right, so I hope that helped everybody else that was listening to that particular discussion. What have you got now?
Melinda says, thank you so much. It does help. Hugs and kisses.
Good. I'm glad it helps. You know, I'm always here every week, Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. We're going to try to make this a regular thing, and I'd like to be able to do more shows. So for those of you that really like what you're hearing, you can always go to the Ask the Unicorn site and leave a donation so that I can get better equipment so that I can do better shows. All you have to do is go to www.askTheUnicorn.com and look at the donation button and press it and leave a donation of a couple of thousand million.
$1 million.
Or whatever. Actually, I'm trying to save up a lot of things. You know, that brings up something. I've started a coin drive, and my goal is to reach 1 million coins. If I can reach 1 million coins, that means pennies, nickels, dimes, quarters, 50-cent pieces, gold dollars, or those funny colored dollar things, then I will be able to get a lot of different equipment, a lot of really good equipment so they can put on better shows. Not only that, I will give a third of the proceeds to a charity that is local. So if you all want to help, send in your bags of coins, send in your buckets of coins, and you can always email us. You can go to our site and let us know that you're going to send those coins. That would be awesome. Now, let me go on to some more questions. Remember, if you'd like to call in, the number here is area code 207-347-5686. And for those of you that have questions that you'd like to write, you can go to the Facebook. Was it the Ahura Z Facebook page and ask your questions there. We'll get them right here, and I will be more than happy to answer them for you. Now, if you've got something going on in your life that is of a paranormal nature that you'd like to discuss with me, fine. We can do that right here on the show, and I can get you an answer as quickly as possible. If there's a problem that comes up in your life or in your energy or anything like that, I will give you the quickest possible solution. That's what it really is about. It's just solutions. If there's something that you need to that will benefit you that you need to get to, I will do my absolute best to make sure that you get to that benefit. The main thing is that we find ways to encourage peace in your life, the understanding of the metaphysical and paranormal and the mystical, without all of the hooey and all of the weird things that we have been taught about the metaphysical and the mystical. All right, what have you got for me next?
How is it possible for someone to curse someone else's property / home? Is it possible? How can it be turned around?
Yes, it is possible. And there is no how it is possible, it just is possible. Not only that, it can be pretty probable. Remember, thought carries with it a lot of energy, and focused thought carries with it even more energy. And if this person has decided to concentrate a lot of thought on an object, they could affect the energy of that object, not necessarily the object itself, but the energy of that object, which I guess is the object. And if you're someone that is handling the object that this person has happened to focus an awful lot of really, really bad thought on it, then you will be the one that reaps the non-benefit of that particular object. You just kind of have to protect yourself, and there are different methods of protecting yourself. For instance, prayer is always a very wonderful way of protecting yourself. However, there are different spells that would be considered counter spells or banishment spells or protective spells. And, you know, a lot of people like to do binding spells, which I guess has its place, but in my particular case, the moment that you decide to bind something, you pretty much bind it to yourself because it's your energy that you use in order to bind something. So it's far better for you to banish it. Banish it and then offer yourself some protection. Now, for you to ask that particular question means that you may have something that could possibly be cursed, or maybe you have incurred something like that. If you have, there are ways of getting rid of that. One of the ways that you can get rid of it is by getting rid of the object. Unfortunately, we get very, very attached to things in our lives, and we get very, very attached to concepts and things in our lives, and many times we will keep those objects even in detriment to ourselves. You're going to have to learn to let certain things go, okay? If you have an object which is obviously cursed or obviously bringing about negativity in your life, get rid of it. Forget all the sentiment and forget all of the emotionalism that goes with it. Because I've heard this tons of times. You know, you'll have someone that has got an object into their home and all of a sudden everything went awry and they're wondering what's going on. And I say, where'd you get that thing from? You know? And well, you know, I got it from this person who was just very negative. You know, we split up and, you know, but it reminded me of a good time that we had together. You know, really? At that particular point, what you're supposed to do is, if that, anything about that person is left on that particular object and it is wreaking havoc in your life, I don't care if it was from a really good time that you went to the carnival and had a great time. Get rid of it. Get it out of your life. Okay? No, you don't have to send it back to that person because that's just a big game. I listen to that crap all the time. People will say, well, you know, I need to send it back to them because it's closure. Listen, you're not looking for closure. You're looking to justify yourself going back and seeing if that person is still available for you to work your magic on. You know, the best thing that you can do is walk the other way. There's a reason that you split up with someone. You don't need to go back and revisit it. What, you're going to split up again and then get mad at the person because they didn't act better than they did the last time? So, you know, the best thing that you can do is take everything that that person gave you in a little box and get rid of it. I don't care how you get rid of it. And if you want to really have compassion and not leave that person's negativity on someone else, destroy it and get rid of it. Just get rid of it. Okay, now that's one method. The other thing is you can learn how to do a counterspell, how to do something that will banish things, that will cause other curses that have been set against you to be null and void, to be totally ineffectual, or to even use what we call in this particular world a divine boomerang, so that whatever they shoot at you goes back at them faster and harder. All of these methods are available to you, and if you're really interested in how to do this and you're just not looking for a band-aid, I do teach classes. I teach classes, and I teach my classes in six-week increments, or either 6 weeks or 3 months. That's up to you. I don't teach for free. For those of you that believe that you should be able to learn things such as mysticism and metaphysics for free, you are kidding yourself. It is the same as going to a university. Okay? You don't go up to them and say, well, you know, I think that I should be able to just waltz in here and do my classes for free, because they'll laugh at you. I won't laugh at you, but I'll educate you. If you're interested in classes, you can go to the Unicorn Cove School of Metaphysics site, and that is www.unicorn-cove.com, and you can look up some of the classes that we have there. I teach both classes in metaphysics and those things that are manual. So if you really want to learn about how to get rid of these things, I will teach you, and there are other teachers as well. Now, the possibility of there being a spell, you know, we are interesting in this way that we always believe that something has to be possible, or we try to open up what the possibilities are. But listen, the impossible happens daily, okay? The improbable takes a little longer, but the impossible is something that happens every single day. Yes, a person can focus enough energy on you to curse you. And you know something? If you're not educated and you don't understand, then you wind up being a victim of this particular thing. There are those that say, well, you know, I choose not to believe in negativity. And I choose not to believe, oh, well, goody for you. The fact is that curses and blessings have existed long before you and me. And guess what? I always say this because it's the truth. The pre-existence of a thing negates your belief or disbelief. The bottom line is this. There are things out there that will help you, and there are things out there that will hurt you. There are blessings. A person can truly do a blessing towards you, not those people that, you know, you don't think like them, so they say things like, well, you know, you're going to be blessed, and the blessings will overtake your life. You know, that's a load of hooey, because they really don't have any idea what a blessing is. There are people that do have an idea what blessings are, and they can focus just as much thought on you, and that blessing will help you if you so accept it. The one thing is that you need to be educated so you can either accept or reject either one. To curse someone is a blatant violation of their life. However, to bless someone can be a blatant violation as well, especially if they're not willing to receive that, or if it's a false blessing, or if you're just saying that because it sounds nice. So we have to kind of be careful of the things that we say to each other, and we kind of have to be careful of the things that we accept into our lives. Blessings and curses are real. You just have to know what they are so that you can counteract them, which means you must be educated. So, I hope that helps you. And yes, they can be taken care of, either one. If you know that you don't have the capacity to do these things, you can contact someone like myself and we can uncross you. We can break the curse for you. Okay? So I hope that helps you. Who is that from?
Anonymous. Okay. Next question, that was a continuation of that, was can a person curse another person without realizing they have done it?
Yes. A person can curse another person without realizing what they've done. They just might view it as saying something nasty. But, you know, it depends on what a person says and the thought, the amount of thought that is focused, the amount of thought energy that is focused on that particular person that they're directing it towards. For instance, we lightly curse people all the time. I mean, each other. Parents do it. Kids do it. And, you know, they probably don't mean it to be a curse, but they'll say things like, well, you know, if you go outside without your jacket, you're going to catch cold. You know, don't go outside with your jacket off. You'll catch cold. And you know something? That child will go out one day in 70-degree weather without a jacket and catch a cold. And then who takes responsibility for that? Hopefully the parent does, by learning not to say such things to a person. You know, repetition is one of those things that's also used in a blessing and a curse. You know, and so much repetition, there are people that will do a major atrocity trying to focus a bit of negativity on another person just for their own means. Those things can be very easily countermanded. You know, remember, if you are acting in the right, and if you are acting in good, and not to hurt anyone, that is a power in and of itself. And when you take that particular power and you decide to protect yourself with it, you are fortifying your own energy against such things. So all their curse will do is bounce right off of you. And those people that are out there that are practicing mystics and practicing, I'll say words such as witches, and because again, to say words like Wicca is kind of a mispronunciation, but I'll let you figure that out. But those of you that are practicing in any form of mystical religion, we all know that the cardinal rule is what? Do what you will, but harm none. And that's serious. That's not just a clever saying that someone is supposed to stick on their bumper and parade around. That is real. You are not supposed to hurt anyone, because eventually it will come back at you. And I don't mean, you know, 3 times 3, you know. What I mean is it'll come back to you probably in about 10 times 10, and very, very quickly. Or it may even take a little longer. Sometimes mysticism has this funny way of making you believe that it forgot about you. You know? And then all of a sudden you find that your rear end is in a sling. So it's best not to hurt anybody. It's best not to curse anyone. Try not to say such negative things to everybody, you know, all the time, you know. try not to hope bad things on another person. You know, hope is one of those things that should never be used negative. Hope is the one thing that we all have that kind of keeps us out of hell. So hopefully we learn to, if you can't bless a person, just don't say anything. Don't say anything. Running around cursing people because you're mad at them. And this happens a lot, especially in romantic situations where someone gets mad at somebody else because they don't like them, or they stopped liking them, or, you know, they liked somebody else, or they decided they want to get revenge on this person for some reason or another. So you wind up, you know, cursing them, and eventually you'll wind up cursing yourself. This is just the way that it goes. You can throw your bread upon the water, but guess what? When it comes back, it'll be bigger, and it'll be for you. So it's best not to curse anybody. Don't ask stupid questions of people just so that you can find out how to weaken them. You know, don't go making people paranoid for no reason at all. And at the same time, perhaps what you should do is eliminate the word curse from your vocabulary if you can. Not only that, eliminate the properties that go with it. Old saying in the mystic world and on the street, don't start no mess, there won't be none. Okay? And if you find yourself in trouble, remember, there's always help. Hope that helps you. All right, what have you got for me now?
Next question is from Kat Neal, and she says, when cleansing, being an empath, my hardest thing is to create a bubble and keep others' negativity in my bubble. It is very hard to maintain my personal bubble, so to speak. What do you think is the best way to protect from that negativity when being an empath?
Get rid of the bubble. Remember, the best thing for you to do is to cover yourself. Do something like create a shield. Now, in truth, we have to kind of find things that are going to help us associate. If you know that you have a tendency for negative situations, the best thing for you to do is to start one by one eliminating the negative situation. Things have to be very, very practical. When I am shielding myself, I don't see a bubble. I don't think of it that way. What I think about is that I am a being of light. And because I'm a being of light, I know that there are those that are in the universe that I can ask for protection and get it. Not only can I get it, but they also help me to fortify my own protection. And one of the ways that I do that is not by picking a fanciful type of a thing. I make myself a living shield. Okay? So if you can create yourself, if you can see yourself as being a living shield that nothing can stick to, that nothing can attack, what you will do is you will develop your own intuition so that it can tell you when you're about to enter into a dangerous situation, and that you have a choice not to enter into that dangerous situation or get into that negative situation and walk the other way. That's one of the best things ever. It's funny that we as light beings, we have this propensity to want to always help people, and that's great, but we also have this propensity to put ourselves in overwhelming situations. You know, like, well, I know that I'm protected, so I'm going to walk into hell, you know. Listen, just because you're protected doesn't mean that you're supposed to test it. You know, what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to not test it, okay? You're supposed to make sure that you're protecting yourself, you're protecting your family, and make sure that you are protecting your home. And one of the things that you can say out loud is, Most Holy Father, Divine Mother, I come before you in the name and nature of the Christ I know is Jesus, and ask that no negativity come nigh me nor my dwelling place. For those of you that are Christ-centered, that will very, very, very much help. For those of you that don't understand or even believe in Christ, that's fine too. You just choose the way that you want to do it and say these things. Let no evil come nigh me, nor my dwelling place. I am asking to be guarded, protected, and shielded against all darkness, all negativity, and all evil in all of its forms. Remember, there comes a point in time in spiritual development and spiritual warfare and in defending yourself against psychic attack that you need to be extremely specific. So sometimes you may even have to say, I guard, protect, and shield myself against all darkness, all negativity, and all evil in all its forms, whether it be physical, mental, emotional, astral, etheric, spirit, thought, soul, financial, health, or genetic forms. If you can get all of that out. You don't have to say that. I'm just giving you an example, okay? And I promise you, the more specific that you get, and the better you get at being specific, the more specific your help will be. Remember, energy responds to energy. So in order for you to receive shielding energy, you're going to have to be the living shield. Remember, you've got to be exactly what it is that you're asking for. Okay? It's not just getting on your knees and hoping for, you know, for protection. I was talking to someone earlier today and I was telling him, listen, you know, I know that people like to go out and say, you know, I'm going to use the white light of protection to protect myself. But you know what? I'd far better use the light of invisibility and intangibility to protect myself, because I don't want them seeing me. I don't want them seeing me. I don't want them knowing that I'm there, and I definitely don't want them to touch me. So when you go out there, you know, using that little white light thing, it's like ringing a dinner bell. Here I am. And most of us really don't have an idea of what that white light is. We pick a light that's white. And right now, there's a white light that's staring me right in the face in order for you all to see me. So the bottom line is this. Readjust your thinking. And if you readjust your thinking daily, it will lead you out of negative situations. So you won't have to walk around constantly in a bubble. Because in truth, you can't. In order for you to interact with anyone, you're not going to be able to walk around in a bubble, but you will be able to walk around as a living shield. Think more that way. A shield against negativity, against darkness, and against evil. That should help you. Hope it does. All right, what do you got for me?
This next question is from Marie Thompson. She says, there are times when I wake up in the mornings and there are certain songs which I just cannot get out of my head, and those songs are with me all day. Is there a certain reason why I'm waking with these songs in my head?
Well, there's a lot of different reasons, probably because of it. Sometimes the universe will speak to us in song, and the song may be utterly ridiculous, okay, but there's something in that song that you may need to deal with, or maybe it's trying to show you something that could help you. So next time you have one of those songs stuck in your head, think about what it's saying and see if it matches the situation that you're going through. On another, maybe you just heard a really annoying song, you know, and there's a lot of them. One of the most annoying songs that I ever heard in my life that I could not get out of my head was, I will always love you. Annoying. Okay, and I'm going to pop some tags, I got 20, you know, and I woke up here, and I woke up hearing this song, and I was, okay, that's enough, because in the background, all I could hear was, ba-dup, ba-dup, ba-da-doo-da, you know, so that's kind of what's happening. There's something that's stuck there, and maybe it's something you need to address. It does happen that way. Another time, you may just happen to find something that consciously you don't like, but your subconscious decided to say, hey, that's really cool. I really want to hang on to that song, you know? And if you think about it just for a second, there's a lot of really dumb ones. There's some really good ones that come up, too. Listen to the lyrics sometimes. You know, what was it? Sonari was saying that she kept hearing this techno song in her mind, and she couldn't get it out of her head, you know. But if you listen to techno is really hard to get out of your head anywhere.
That Mick Jagger song that you guys couldn't get out of your heads for a while.
Oh, I could get it out of my head. I didn't have a problem at all, you know.
That's funny.
It's that I'm gonna pop some tags song that I couldn't get out of my head. Anyway, that's usually what happens. Remember, what you consciously like is not necessarily what your subconscious likes. And what you consciously don't like is not necessarily what your subconscious doesn't necessarily like. So it's almost like...
Sorry, Sonari, you said, oh my God, that song is driving me nuts.
Yeah. You know, and it can be like that sometimes. Like, all right, why would I wake up in the morning going, we built this city?
Or Boogie Wonderland.
All right, what's wrong with Boogie Wonderland?
Nothing. I didn't say anything was wrong with Boogie Wonderland.
But, you know, I didn't build the city, you know, yet. But things like that. But it may not be that little stanza of things. Maybe there's something in the entire song. So next time you wake up with a funny song in your head and you can't get it out, listen to the whole song and see if something's there for you. That's one of those things. Down. In the back, there's a little chow chow that is deciding that this is a really good time to play with her little rubber bone. And that's Ling. But anyway, I hope that helps you out.
We do have Elise on the phone, or would you like to go to another question?
Okay, why don't you let me answer the question first?
Okay. This is from Kat again, and she says, I have recently come across something being called a starseed. I was wondering how much you know about it.
A starseed is not a something, it's a someone.
I have recently came across being called a starseed.
Oh, what that basically means is that this is another one of those terms that gets flung around way too often. Basically, it means that your origins are not your origins. That's your oranges. Your oranges. Your origins are not of this particular planet. It means that someone has decided to tell you that, you know, you come from the stars. But we all do. There's been a very, very big awakening of people since the comet Izon has passed and dissipated. We're still in a lot of what it left behind, which is causing people to wake up, and a lot of things that have that were in Izon actually affected us on a mass scale. So it's waking up certain parts of us. That's what's meant as a starseed, which basically means that you're one of the universal children or universal people that are have another origin besides Earth. That's what that's about. You might do some more studying on it. It is really quite interesting, you know. But that basically means something that you've always known, that you're special. And we all are special in our own way. However, star seeds means that there's a seed of an extraterrestrial being that is within you. Sorry, I sounded really New Agey and airy fairy then. I did not mean to, but you know, the whole term of starseed just brings that up.
Brings
up lunch, really. But you know, a starseed is actually real, and that basically means that there's something on the inside of you that is emerging. And we'll just have to wait for it to emerge to tell you exactly what that is. Hopefully it's positive, because there are negative star seeds as well. You know, so that's very, very good. And if you need more an observation, you can always come in and see me, which you haven't done in years.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to go to Elise right now. Just put on speakerphone.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you, Elise? You're okay. That didn't sound okay.
Well, I have a question, and my husband just texted me that he has a question, so is it okay to ask two questions?
Sure.
Okay, well, my question is, my mother just passed away on Saturday, and since then, I keep having dreams of sitting at tables with her and eating. The first dream was that, I was sitting with my sister, and who's also in the spirit world, and my mother, and we were all wearing white, like white robes, and we were sitting at a white table eating white food, like that we had cooked together, and it was really a peaceful environment. But I never got along with her when she was living on the earth.
Okay.
I don't know what that means, if that means anything. And then the second dream, I had a dream that we were sitting in a garden with, and she was reading Psalm 23, and she said, "And God shall prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies." And then appeared on the table was a plate of grapes, a goblet of wine, and some honey.
Mana means power.
It means power?
Mm-hmm. That's what mana is.
Okay.
Mana is energy.
Okay, so I don't understand why I would dream of that of my mother if I don't know. I was pretty sure that my mother didn't like me very much.
Well, maybe it was your mother's way of making peace between you. You said that everything was white. Well, according to the vibrational frequency chart, white is also the color of purity.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm. And it maybe she just wanted to clear the way between you, which means that there's no karma between the two of you.
Oh, okay.
Do you understand?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is. And as far as the mana, maybe that food that was there, the grapes, right? It was grapes, right?
Right.
Is something that holds mana for you and that you should investigate.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so that should help you. I think it's just your mother's way or the universe's way of creating a peaceful environment so that you have nothing to be begrudging about with your mother anymore. And she has nothing to do.
I started writing all the good things that she ever did for me in my life, and that's going to make it like into a children's book with illustrations.
Okay.
Oh, cool.
That's good. Well, we know that you're a wonderful artist.
I didn't catch what you said because it was cutting in and out.
I said we know that you're a wonderful artist.
Oh, thanks.
So what was Tal's question? Well, a lot of people ask that particular question, and this is the way that I have to address it. Now, I understand you and Tal are Christian,
yeah.
So I need to speak to you as a Christian. You have to remember one major part of everything that happens on this world. If you read your Bible, you go back, you understand that dominion over this earth was given to Satan, remember?
It's kind of cutting in and out. You said read the Bible and remember that.
You need to hold it to your phone. To your mouth, excuse me.
I need to hold it to my mouth.
Hold it to your
phone. Can you hear me now?
I might be able to hear you if I lower my phone and turn on the computer. Is that okay?
No, if you do that, you're going to get a lag. So it's better, you know, if we try to do it this way. I'll just answer the question for you, and you have to understand something. A lot of us forget that particular part, that this world, or according to the Bible, this world was given, the dominion of this world was given to Satan.
Yeah.
And understand that it's been like that forever. It doesn't mean that it's still given to Satan. What it basically means is that we that are good people have to do something in order to dethrone that particular evil. But there are good people and there are evil people on this earth. And yes, for a time it does seem as though the tyrants win. But they don't always win. It just appears that way. You know, the fact that we have money at all, or have to pay for things at all, that a person has to actually determine what their self-worth is or what their worth is based upon a little piece of paper is absolutely ridiculous. That goes beyond evil. It's into foolery, you know. But, you know, I trust this. I trust that at some point in time, we will overthrow that particular regime, and that those that are negative will go with those that are negative, and there'll be a massive separation of those that choose to be good and evolved and those that choose to be bad and de-evolved. And that's something that we all have to work towards. But to answer your question, that's why, is that the dominion of this world, according to the Bible and many other different writings, the dominion of this world was given to evil. And it's us good ones that have to turn the tide.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. You know, so if we like to pick and choose certain things, and that's fine. You can pick and choose your own truth, but realize that there are some things that are true. And you can see it by the way the things are. It seems as though people that are doing bad and evil, you know, get all of the things. And there are a lot of people out there, and I listen to this tons of times, you know, especially when it comes to things like money, relationships, and you'll find these perfectly good people that are wonderful in relationships and just want the opportunity to have a really good one, yet someone who really doesn't care or someone that is just trouncing their relationship get all the opportunities. It doesn't make sense. Or someone who really doesn't need the money winds up getting all the money, you know, and not sharing it, not giving it to people. They'll find some association that they can get a tax write-off for it, you know. Even if you got $30 billion, listen, that's enough. You really don't need more. Yeah, I'd be perfectly happy with about $3 million because I'd help a lot of other people prosper. You know, so it takes patience. It takes the willingness to turn the tide. That's what it really takes. You tell Tal to hang in there, all right?
Okay, I'll tell him that you said that. Thanks.
All right. You take care. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
That was Elise. All right, we're getting some pretty decent questions here. You know, for those of you that don't appreciate Bible talk, I'm sorry. That's, you know, this is something that I do. I answer questions, and, you know, I pull from different information, and I know my own thoughts and my own knowledge, and that includes writings of the Bible, because as I have one, it's right up there, and I do read it, and I know what it says, and I also know what it doesn't say, you know. So hopefully you all benefit from that. I understand your thoughts on religion, and, you know, religion has done much, much travesty, and I'm sorry for that. And what I have come to know is that religion has made people not like God, not want to be God's friends, because they've given the wrong idea of God. The God that I know and the goddess that I don't, that I know, are not cruel. They are not menacing, nor are they waiting to throw someone into a lake of fire. But, you know, if you choose that particular type of God, understand that's not the one that you should be choosing. That's the other guy, you know. And hopefully you choose your own path. Even if you decide to believe in a lantern, as long as you believe in something, as long as you have something that means something to you. All right, what have we got next?
Charlie asks, can negative energy / positive energy be picked up by food prepared by another, such as fast food or a restaurant, etc.?
What do you mean, that it can you be affected by such things? Yes, definitely. And yes, food can have energy infused into it. A person's thoughts can get into the energy. It's what I was talking about last week. If you go to a place that you know that the service is crappy, you probably should just get up and leave, because whoever's cooking that food and preparing that food will focus their thought on that food, and you'll wind up eating it, and your food will be full of their thought, good or bad. So pick and choose where it is that you're going to eat. One of the best things that you can do is cook your own meals. I'm not downing the restaurant industry, although there are places that think it's really cool to have a triple cheeseburger smothered in cheese.
Just kidding.
You know, but you know, you have to watch where you eat, because if that person back there is just spouting all types of negativity, the last thing that you want to do is eat their food. But if you go to a place where you know the person just loves to cook and loves everything about food, and realizes that their food is going to be eaten by people, so they think positive things, you know, about their food, by all means, go to that place. Okay, and it may not be the fanciest restaurant. It may just be a little hole in the wall or a little roach coach, you know. You know, because listen, one of the best places that I've ever eaten in my life was this place in Los Angeles that was called Tommy Burger. And then it was rivaled by a place that was called Fat Burger. And then I discovered McDonald's, and that was probably not a great idea, but, you know, I've given all that stuff up. But what I'm saying is that some of the best food came from the most humble places. And, you know, Charlie, you know this. You do know that food affects. Food can make you either feel really great or it can totally screw you up. Same with coffee, tea, drinks, whatever. Even being in a place that is negative all the time can make you sick. So it's better for you to really discriminate. Don't just go to a place because someone wants to go to it. Determine whether or not it's going to be beneficial to you. And if it is, by all means. If it's not, don't do it. I don't care who wants you to do it. And you know something? I have to say this. Because I've seen people say, well, you know, it's a place that I really want to go. I don't care. If it's a place that I know is going to make me sick, I'm not going to go there. You know? I've seen relationships split up over things like this. You know? Well, you're just so controlling. You don't want to go where I want to go. No, because I don't want to get sick. Okay? It's far better for me to be nice and healthy than to go someplace just because you want to go and be sick. You know, that doesn't make sense. And you should all take that into consideration. Don't go throwing guilt trips on people because they don't want to eat at Chez Boujon. I don't even know if that's a real tone, but you know what I'm saying. You know, don't get mad at a person because they don't want to eat where you want to eat, or don't want to eat food that just tastes like cardboard because it's a delicacy. You know,
the ginormous white plate with like a piece of food that's big.
Well, they call that food technology, food science, or food whatever. You know, where they just mix little things together and you wind up paying $20 for a plate of food about that big, you know, of stuff that you're supposed to be really cool about and say, well, you know, it's all the rave. No. What's all the rave is I eat good food that is nourishing to my body. Okay? That is all the rage with me. You know, so hopefully that helps you out. Yes, food can carry vibrations. All right. What else have you got for me?
Cat Neil asks, what do you recommend for the best grounding as far as food? I'm having vertigo balance issues this past month.
Really? Something that is low in fat and low in cholesterol. And if you can have, you might be from a protein deficiency. So you might want to get yourself checked out. You know, if you don't like doctors, go to one of the holistic doctors, see if they can do some things with you. A lot of times, a diet can determine such things. Your blood pressure may be off. Maybe it's really low. Maybe it's really high. You know, I suggest you get these things checked out. But always, a low-fat diet helps. Low-salt diet helps. Really low-salt diet, that should help you. Okay? You don't have to really watch the calories. I know that America is declared war on calories. But calories isn't the issue. It's all of the different additives in food. It's all of the different chemical compositions of food. It's all of the different things that are in food that we don't need. Okay? No matter what anyone says to you, there is no reason to put salt in everything. I don't care what people try to tell you. Okay? We Americans, we eat... We're supposed to have, what, 2,500 milligrams of salt per day, or sodium per day. Most of us eat between 10 and 15,000 milligrams of salt per day. Even you people doing the Weight Watchers thing, okay? You really need to watch that. It can affect you poorly. You know, you just don't want it. So check out those things. You might also consider... Maybe you're eating too much meat. Maybe you're not eating enough meat. You know, I'm an omnivore, so I don't subscribe one way or another to, you know, vegetarianism or meatitarianism or whatever. That's up to the person's makeup. You know, sometimes I have meat, sometimes I don't want it. You know, it just depends. You know, try not to get into the political part of it where people say things like meat is murder. That's the most absurd thing ever. If you don't want to eat meat, that's your business. Don't go spreading your poison to other people, okay? Some people need meat for grounding, and meat is one of the best ways to stay grounded. I hate to tell you this, but it's the truth.
Meat is the power.
Yeah. And so renegotiate your diet, okay? Vegetables help. There's some things, some grains can help. Don't go on a grain binge. And you know that whole Atkins diet thing? Stop doing that crap. Stop it. Okay, you need a healthy mix of everything. Fruits and vegetables are always really, really good. You know. And just be balanced about it. Don't go eating huge mountains of food because you really don't need it. At the same time, make sure you're eating enough. Don't go starving yourself. Okay, for those of you that, you know, that refuse to eat because you want to be super thin, you know, wind up sucking air through a rice cake and calling that a meal. That's ridiculous. Eat a good, healthy meal, okay? It's all right. Nobody will penalize you if you have a really good meal. Okay, I hope that helps you out. Okay, what are we doing for time?
It is 9 o'clock.
Okay. I have a few more questions. Time for a few more questions. Anything there?
We have a response, Pete, for our molecular gastronomy what it was called. Thank you.
Yes, molecular gastronomy. That's just funny. I just need a plate of food. I don't need all of that stuff, you know.
We have a couple questions.
Okay, what do you got?
Annabelle asks, so when an exorcist is fighting a demon, is it their personal energy that protects them, willpower, God's energy, or something else?
Yes.
All of the above. Okay.
Just that simple.
The next question then is, as Earth's energy rises, do you foresee magic happening more often than it did?
Earth's energy is what Earth's energy is always supposed to be. Yet magic is returning. So, yes, magic is returning, and there will be the availability of much more. In fact, I think that people are already beginning to see manifestations of that. So those of us that are magic users, those of us that thrive off of magic, will finally be fed again. So, yes. Okay. And what was the second half of that?
That was it.
Okay. What else you got?
Let me check to see if we have any more questions. Do we have any more questions?
All right. No more questions.
I just asked. Hold on.
No.
Okay.
Well. For those of you that have joined us tonight, I thank you for joining us. And if you have any other questions, because sometimes it's really difficult to think of a question on the fly, write your questions down, okay, so that you can, you know, ask them next week, okay? This is our second video show. We're doing pretty good, I think. We're getting better at setting things up and making sure that things are properly lit, you know, and I will try to get the recorded show to you. I will try to get the recorded show to you, you know. So in the meantime, check us out on Facebook, the Uhurizi page, and also the Unicorn Cove School of Metaphysics page. You might check us out and see if you can find the, see if we have the video playing for you. Okay, tell your friends about the show. The more people that we have, the better that it's going to be, okay? I'd like to have lots and lots of viewers, all right? So, no more questions?
Nope.
All right, then. Thank you very much for joining us. This has been Ask the Unicorn. I'm Uhurizi. And
I'm Kazi, Nira Kazi.
Thank you all for joining us. Have a wonderful evening. See you next week.